Hello everyone, this is Dr. Utkarsh Maheshwari from Dr. D.Y. Patil Institute of Engineering Management and Research. I am from Chemical Department. Today I will be talking about my week 3 and week 4 learning from the International FDP on Environment and Sustainability. Okay. To start with, these are the details of the week 1 and week 2 videos. The week 1 video is basically talking about what environment and sustainability is. Whereas the week 2 videos are having the details of what are the different standards associated with the water treatment and specifically from the ISO standards. So the learning videos, learning from the previous videos were why the need of the water treatment process is specifically what is the meaning of the water environment and sustainability. Later I had discussed about what are the different norms and standards related to water. There will be different ISO standards which are applicable for the water treatment. Now, when we are talking of water treatment, I have talked about that there are 23,000 standards of ISO, out of which approximately 1,200 standards are specifically for water treatment itself. Treatment means it will be related to water. That may be in the treatment, for the treatment, for the storage, for the transportation, whatever it is. So it is related to water. So those 1,200 are there. Later, I discussed about the pollution abatement processes, what can be the different processes. And finally, I have talked about the risk management, what can be associated with when we are talking about water treatment. Okay. So that was the learning from the videos. Now, to start with the further one, that these are the standards of ISO, which are related to water systems. Now, these are only a few. I'm talking of there are more than 1,200. But these are only a few I have listed down. ISO 14046. This is related to this provides the basic requirements for the measurement and reporting of water footprint, setting an international benchmark for water use. Like carbon footprint, I will be talking about carbon footprint after these slides. But like carbon footprint, we are having water footprint. So that is what that the utilization of water, the effect of water availability altogether will be giving you. The water footprint. So this ISO 14046 is related to that. Further, ISO 16075. This provides the guidelines for treated wastewater to be used in the irrigation project. Because definitely there is a specific process then or specific procedure to be followed so that the water can be used again in the irrigation project. Similarly, there are furthermore ISO standards which are related to water. One or another way, that would be the case. Now, let's talk about the carbon footprint. When we say the carbon footprint for wastewater treatment, first we have to understand what carbon footprints are. Carbon footprints are nothing but it is related to how much a carbon dioxide is released as a result of a different activities. Like it can be the activity because of an individual, it can be an activity which is related to because of an organization. Or it can be an activity which is related to a community. Altogether, it is telling you that what amount of carbon dioxide will be released because of these all different processes altogether. It's not for individual, it is for all together who all are involved will be giving you that carbon footprints. And in most of the cases, like if I talk of a normal, in my case, and I am saying that okay, I am from DYPMI. So what's the carbon footprint of DYPMI? Now, I can try to calculate the value of carbon footprint for DYPMI, but it will be very difficult to get the exact count that what will be the carbon footprint. It will be somewhat a nearby value which the carbon footprint of DYPMI will give. Because it will be very difficult to incorporate all the options available. I can include the new persons involved. I can include the electric equipments involved. I can include the processes involved, but still there will be something which will be left out, which will not be considered, which we have not considered. So we can't give the exact count. That's why it's very difficult to get an exact quantity because of the inadequate knowledge of a complex interaction between the contributing processes. Like Abhi, if I'm talking of a human being, now there are 100 staff which is available in DYPMI. Now, the, how the at the time of when they're interacting with each other, at the time of different processes, how the carbon footprint is varying, how the carbon evaluation is different, that is very difficult to understand. So that's why it's not, it will give approx calculation, but not the exact calculation. Okay. And this is why some of the scientists have specifically proposed the definition of carbon footprint as a measure of total amount of carbon dioxide and methane emissions of a defined population, system, or activity, considering all the relevant sources, sinks, and storage within the spatial and the temporal boundary of the population, system, and the activity of interest. Now, the calculated as a carbon dioxide equivalent using the relevant 100-year global warming potential. Now, altogether, if you go with this definition, what it says, first thing is, it's not only the carbon dioxide. The methane, which is also a greenhouse gas, will be also considered to see that how much of the carbon footprint will be. So carbon footprint will not be only the CO2, it will also be the methane involved. Other than this, what they're looking for, that because of the exhale of CO2 and CH4, how much amount of the global warming in the next 100 year will increase. So that is how they are trying to calculate that from now, that's the present scenario. And if we talk of 100 year of global warming potential, how it will vary, that will be giving me what will be my carbon dioxide equivalent. And finally, that will give me what will be my carbon footprint. Now, further, if I talk about the different sustainable processes, if you talk of processes involved. Now, when we say the processes involved, like this is a typical wastewater treatment plant, which is available, means I've taken it from a reference. So if you talk of when you talk of a wastewater treatment, depending on the pollutants, depending on the processes, they are available in numbers. That I can't say that, okay, it's only a 4 process, 5 process. There are number of wastewater treatment processes. Now, here it is a single system which I have explained. Now, if you talk of this system, MIX, what will happen? There are different processes, like spray treatment, aeration is there, then MIX treatment is there, then coagulation, clarification is there, then filtration is there. Now, when we talk of a different processes, the carbon footprint will be because of what? The carbon footprint will be because of this spray aeration. The carbon footprint will be of because of this MIX treatment. Just a minute. So the carbon footprint is because of this spray aeration. The carbon footprint is because of this MIX treatment. The carbon footprint is because of this coagulation clarification, and the carbon footprint will be because of this filtration. So all together, this will be the case, that aeration. That means when I'm talking of a carbon footprint of this whole process gives me a carbon footprint when I'm adding up the carbon exhale from this spray aeration, I add up a carbon exhale from this MIEX treatment, I add up a carbon treatment from this coagulation, clarification, and a filtration. That means all together, if there are 10 processes involved, the effect of that individual 10 all together will give you the whole process. And also, there is an addition because of the interaction between the two. That will be the case. Now, when we calculate the greenhouse gas emissions from this relief, like if you talk of this process specifically, as per the literature available, what I have evaluated that when we calculate the greenhouse gas emissions from the delivery of 1 meter cube of the water from the groundwater surface, water and the seawater, specifically this is talking about the Western Australia. So there will be a liberation of, if I'm using a groundwater, I'm getting a 0.38 kg of carbon dioxide. For 1 meter cube of water, 1 meter cube means 1,000 kgs. Okay. On the other hand, if I'm talking of surface water, I will be getting a 0.42 kg of water, a 0.42 kg of CO2. Whereas if it's a sea water where a desalination is required, so it will be 2.46 kg of CO2 available that will be the case. So that means when you see the type of water which we are looking for, the type of process I'm looking for, it will give me the increase in the CO2 emission. That means nothing but the greenhouse gas emissions. That will be the case. So when I'm talking of greenhouse gas emissions from the seawater desalination treatment plant, which is about 6.5 to 5 times of the emission from the Western Australian process. So Western Australian process means if you talk of this groundwater and the surface water which is given away. So seawater will give you a desalination process. That is a 2.46. And if you see this 2.46, and if you see the value which is giving in 0.38 and 0.42, so that means that groundwater and the seawater is, if you consider it one, means if you see the ratio of this desalination process and the normal groundwater and the surface water process, it gives you 6.5 to 5 times of the greenhouse gas emissions. Okay. Similarly, if you talk of electrodialysis desalination treatment plant, this is giving you one of a very high amount of the greenhouse gases. That means wherever possible, we should not be using this desalination process. Possible, I'm saying it's a possibility, because definitely if I'm looking for the utilization of the water from the seaways, see, definitely I will be looking for the greenhouse emissions because of the electrodialysis. That will be the case. So this is what, how we will be calculating the carbon dioxide emissions and finally nothing but the greenhouse gas emissions. That will be the case. Now, if I'm talking of a sustainable process, like I just talked to you about, there are number of processes which are actually sustainable in nature in the wastewater treatment, but there are some methods which are not actually sustainable. So we have to justify that whether my system, whatever I'm evaluating, is sustainable or not. That is my justification required. How to do that? Like what we will be doing, that sustainable wastewater treatment. This is one aerobic granular sludge process which I have explained here. What is the situation here? That here it's a normal process where the water is there and we are just putting an aerobic granular sludge. That means that some granules are there, and what we are putting? We are putting air inside. So we are reducing the interaction of any other process. We are just putting influent is coming, water is coming, and along with water, air is coming. So what will happen? Because air is coming and water is coming, there will be the sludge will be bubbled out, and there will be a liberation of the sludge separate, and we will be getting a little bit pure water to it. And what will happen? It will go for 75% lower land footprint, because there will be less amount of the water required, land required. It will go up to the 50% of the investment cost, because there is no other processes involved. Now, only the two, air is inlet and influent is inlet. So what will happen? 30% to 48% of the lower energy output will be there. Utilization will be there. And definitely when there low energy is there, when less investment is there, definitely that will give you a better efficiency as well as the quality of the effluent. That will give. And because it will be the granulation, the aeration is there taking place, it will give you a lower sludge production, and the biopolymer for the industrial application can be easily produced in this method. Okay, so this is one just example I'm just taking it. So there may be a different processes of the water treatment, and we have to just judge it whether it's a sustainable or it's not. That varies depending on what process I'm looking for, and that varies depending on what system and how I'm going to interact with that process. Okay, so this is all about this. So if you talk of the overall learning from the whole course, because now this is the last video, so the whole course is, I'm able to understand what is environment and sustainability is altogether. Later, I will be able to understand why there is a need of the water treatment. Then what are the different related ISO standards for the water treatment are. Further, in this recent video, I'm able to understand what carbon footprints are. And why it is important to understand what carbon footprints are and how they are evaluated, how the calculations of that carbon footprint can be done. And finally, we are able to understand that what are the different sustainable treatment methods and how we can understand whether it's a sustainable or not. That will be then. So with this, I'm stopping it here. Thank you guys for listening patiently. Thank you.